Let's rock and roll, boys.
Hello and welcome to another Nintendo podcast. I am Austin Cummings and I am joined by Matt Schultz and Andrew Watson. How are you doing, boys?
Great.
Oh, doing good.
Oh,
doing
good.
We're doing good.
Excellent. Nearly like we rehearsed. Hey, we're excited. We're excited to be here today. And today's topic for the episode topic is 1 week out, really, from the launch of Super Smash Brothers.
Smash.
If any of you
Smash
guys
Eve.
Can believe it. Well, that's because right. Technically, we're what is Smash? Technically, we're recording this on November 27th, but you know it's going to take me three to five days to edit this bad boy, then another to get it up, and, you know, in any event, we're about a week out, and we're very excited. But before we begin, Matt, tell us a little bit about this kind of special project you've been kind of dreaming up.
Okay, so I think after episode of failure, I'm hoping that if you are on our YouTube channel right now, you're seeing our faces, our beautiful faces. We've got
so beautiful.
Andrew right above me. Oh, hey, Andrew, how's it going?
Brady Bunch.
And over to the my left, stage right, I guess, we've got Austin. And hey, Austin.
I want to say a little something briefly about this.
Yeah, go
so
for
we've
it.
Done a couple. Thank you. We've done a couple attempts at getting the video to work before. And on multiple occasions, we've done this bit where we're like, oh, we'll look in like various directions. And I always end up cutting it from the audio podcast because it sounds very busy and confused. And what I want to say by that is I love that we're still doing it.
Yeah,
I support that.
So it's
and
exciting.
Here we are.
Hopefully we'll add, this is just the beginning. There'll be more visuals and things in the future. But I think the first thing we want to do is maybe put up something more than just the thumbnail of our video for an hour or whatever it is.
An hour or two, whatever it is, it's too long. Well, Matt, thank you for doing it. And we also were kind of discussing putting like a little something in the frame, you know, to like really encourage people to like, hey, go home, open youtube.com, ask your parents before going online, put it in the web browser, and then in each one of our frames is like a fun piece of Nintendo memorabilia. Matt, what do you have on your person today?
Oh, we've got Bullet Bill over here to my left.
You want to bring him up?
Yeah, maybe
the camera.
So, I work at a university, and every year the student staff I work with, we have a theme to our what our year is going to be, and they picked
Bullet Bill.
Mario World. Yeah,
Bill
we're all Bullet Bills. So prior to their move-in, I went and bought 15 different Nintendo character plushies, and this was the one I got to keep. Was our Bullet Bill here. So
I got to keep one.
Well, I gave the rest away to each of the 15 staff, and none of them wanted Bullet Bill. And actually, I think this is one of the nicer ones. So Bowser is like this big, which is pretty cool. He's proportionate. So yeah, I'll probably have. We all have a lot of Nintendo knickknacks. So what do we got? Yeah. What do you got, Andrew? A PlayStation 4 controller in the background.
Wow, yeah, DualShock 4, great controller.
Got it. That's my favorite Nintendo thing.
Very good.
There's also this little Pikachu thing.
Oh, that's so nice.
Cool. Oh, that was...
and I had a lot of fun with that when that came out. It's from Pokemon Rumble for
worth
the Wii U.
Money.
Oh, that's right.
These things are worth money, Austin.
Worth real USD.
Real no less. Dollars.
And I have a big boy Pikachu, which is kind of how I feel physically, kind of in comparison, just like very large. And the this Pikachu, Detective Pikachu, we got a little trailer for that with Ryan Reynolds. Very cute, very fun. That movie looks totally bizarre, and I'm very into it. We don't need to talk about it now, but
I can't wait until we do
looks
talk
crazy.
About it.
Okay, let's do this now. We're gonna start this off with that, and then following that, we're gonna talk about an icebreaker. Let's rock and roll, boys. So. Let's all go around. This is the season of thanks. It's a season of family, and it's a season of Reggie. So let's all go around and talk a little bit about, you know, what we're thankful for, particularly in the world of Nintendo gaming. Matt, do you want to give us a little something?
Yeah, I'm thankful for Mario Party. Mostly because it's the only game any of my non-Nintendo fan family like remembers from growing up and has seen recently in commercials and has asked me to download or play with them without solicitation. So that's been really nice. I was recently home in California, and multiple family members who own Switches, some don't even know what the Switch is, and that's a true statement, know that Mario Party is out again. They're like, oh, I heard there's a new Mario Party, and it looked kind of like the old one. I hear it's pretty good. So I got my whole family to play together. And we have I have a long story about it, but long story short, we had a super competitive game, and mm-hmm. we had one computer playing, and the computer beat all of us. It was
very good,
which I feel like hadn't happened in the game mm-hmm. for a while.
It's a holiday message of hubris, and I like that even for them, the casual kind of non-Nintendo gamer, but just had this encounter with the Mario Party app. Even for them, you like can't pull a fast one on them. They're like, oh, it looks like the same game as always, but this one's the 11th time. And I like that it's a shared experience from gamer and non-gamer alike. Andrew, what are you thankful for?
Well, you know, I'm really thankful for Smash coming out soon, obviously.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
But
for sure.
I'm mostly there. Or I reckon.
Oh, howdy.
All right, I'm pretty thankful for Red Dead Redemption.
Oh, Nintendo switcheroo.
PlayStation 4.
Tell us a little bit about that. You've been playing a lot of that RDR 2, Astromech Droid. Yeah. Tell me about
playing
it.
Playing a whole lot of that.
Mm-hmm.
It's great. It's amazing. It's a step above like mm-hmm. most video games out right now.
Mm-hmm.
I can't think of another game besides like
would you say it's the best like open world experience you've had in a game?
Yeah.
And you played through Spider-Man, and did you play through Breath of the Wild?
Yeah.
So
it's definitely like the best. It just feels so alive, whether it really, you know, is or not. But
a lot of experts believe it is living and breathing. This is happening. You know, it's like it's a Westworld. The Andrew, what are your thoughts on the? You've beaten it now. Are you still gonna play it more?
I mean, the online stuff looks really fun. Mm-hmm. I'm excited to make my own cowboy. Although Arthur is.
Isn't there battle royale mode coming?
Bad A.
Not yet, but I'm sure it's a matter of
there
weeks.
There actually is. There is like there? There's like one mode where you only have bows and knives and like tomahawks.
Hunger Games, Western
and then
style.
One like rocket launcher in the middle. It's like good. I've been playing it as well, and like Andrew said, it really does feel the attention to detail is off the charts, and also just really the good performances and the visuals and the music. It's awesome. We won't dwell on it too long, but. Okay, my quick, what I'm thankful for is that I just went on a trip to South Africa to visit my sister in the Peace Corps and had a great, great time. Went with my grandmother, and it was all grand, but, you know, the Switch gave me that portable gaming on the go, which is to say portable gaming, and I had, you know, I'm certainly thankful for that. I'm thankful for my backup battery, because certainly I needed it after 3 hours of playing
right.
Switch.
Yeah.
But also, I want to say this, I'm thankful for all, you know, 2018, we're about to have Smash, but we didn't have quite as many big standout exclusives as we did last year. We didn't have a Breath of the Wild, we didn't have an Odyssey, you know, Mario Party not quite as big, Tennis not quite as big. And but I am thankful for the many, many indie games that kind of came to Switch, games like Hollow Knight that I really got into the Breach, things of that nature. And I did not manage to play the games I had intended to on the flight, but I did play through The Messenger, which I very, very much enjoyed. And,
oh, okay.
100%
you beat it?
As well as, as well as Mega Man 11, and was just really, you know, delighted by a lot of these smaller games. Thankful for that. That as well, boys.
It definitely was the year of the indie for Nintendo.
The year of the common man, which is kind of a, you know, a recurrent message we kind of hear, you know, that America's lost touch with like common man in the 2016 election and whatnot, and I think that's kind of a reflection we're seeing now on our, you know, the digital Switch landscape. Boys, let's video podcast take commentary. Hands. Take hands for Thanksgiving and say thank you. Very good. There it is. Excellent. A giving of the palms, which is a classic Thanksgiving tradition here in the States for listeners. International listeners may not be familiar with the little
there could
praise
be some.
Up we just did. There could be. Yeah. They were very lost. Okay, let's take it on to a new segment, partner. We like to call Big Man in the News.
I reckon.
All right, so we have a total of four stories here, and I'm going to start off by Pokemon Let's Go. You know them, you saw them, you caught them. Let's Go sales numbers, they're out for Pikachu and Eevee. But before we begin, funny you should be a fellow.
Reckon I should interrupt you.
Let's all go around really fast. Are we a Pikachu or an Eevee, we feel in spirit? Doesn't matter what version you do or don't own. Matt, what are you?
Pikachu.
Andy?
Like an Eevee, you know? Lots of different shades.
It's kind of interesting because one of them you want to evolve into many things, and the other you don't want to evolve at all. You kind of want to level it up and prevent it.
Yeah, I like that kind of understand on that because you can kind of, you know, the Eevee of many colors. You can kind of be whatever fits, you know, fits your mood, you know, maybe a little darker umber on one day or just like, you know, kind of a
level 100 Pikachu.
Sun of the sun of Vaporeon.
I do like the fun in the sun.
You are known for fun in the sun. Okay, so
hey, random question. Yeah.
Sure.
How long before we see Detective Eevee?
My God, yeah, partner in crime. You could have like a Sherlock Holmes and Watson situation, or like Pikachu's.
They basically have been building this up. You know, we got to read between the lines here. Anyway, so the sales numbers.
And at the end of the movie, there'll be like Eevee will like peek around the door or something.
It's gonna pick up the hat.
Another case. In fact, this is like a definite Nintendo deep cut here, as far as Detective Pikachu goes, but for Detective Pikachu, there is a ebook exclusive prequel, like, children's book for Detective Pikachu, the game, called, like, Case Zero, and you and Eevee, like, do a little mystery. So, you know, it's been seeded in the lore. Sales number. So Black Friday was here in the States last Friday. Sales numbers are out, and Pokemon Let's Go has sold 3 million units already, which is certainly quite a few worldwide. It's selling
everyone on my like Switch friends list. I've got like 25 friends on it. They're all playing.
Yeah, tons of friends. More Pikachus, more Eevee.
It's like all my friends. 80% more than Wii U friends that I had.
Oh no! I'm surprised you even got anywhere near whatever the 95 or whatever you needed to get a pet. That's impressive. So in Japan, it sold an impressive 664,000 units. There's also in this story that I'm reading from GameDaily.biz, they also talk about the fact that it seems to be pushing Switch hardware as well. And Reggie said the other day that the holidays account for 60% of Nintendo's revenue, so they're really, you know, pushing this time. So, you know, fun to see it going well. Andrew, I know you're playing a little bit, as am I. What are your impressions of Pokemon Let's Go?
You're not going to like him, I don't think.
Oh, you're real.
I should be thankful for Austin here because he
loves
supplied it.
He
got it for me.
Well, it wasn't really Christmas for my friend. Mutual friend. And to Andrew. And, you know,
that's you're nice of you.
Thank you.
Mine's in the mail, assuming, right?
But it puts me to sleep.
And that's good?
I cannot play it without drifting off and falling.
You think it's a drowsy?
Because I can't explain it.
It's too easy. Like it's just
too easy. It's the part.
It's like Animal Crossing meets Pokemon. And just
it's not. It just feels like I'm pressing A the whole time. Just like
It's true. The game is really easy. Now I have to say, when I was in Africa, particularly in South Africa, I played a lot of Pokemon Go, and I had fun playing with my sister and trying to get some regional tropes and
follow us on Pokemon Twitter for all of
Follow us on Twitter. It's too close. But the I was enjoying kind of how casual the battling felt, but it's easy. I think that it's less of an issue, my feeling at least, is the catching. In some way, like the catching is very feels relaxed. The world is beautiful. It's just fun to be back, especially in, you know, the Kanto region we all know and love so well. But I will definitely agree with Andrew that it's like I'm just running Pikachu through every scenario. One of the moves you get for Pikachu early on is called Zippy Zap. It always does a critical hit. It always attacks first. So it's extremely powerful, and it kills everything one shot, even Pokemon that are typed poorly against.
So what is the challenge in this game? What's the
Staying awake.
Definitely staying awake.
The nostalgia almost pulled me in, but I don't know. What's the point of battling and trying to level up? Like, what's the incentive to keep battling and grinding? Is there even grinding?
There honestly is no point. And that's maybe why I keep falling asleep.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely an existential question, Matt. So I appreciate your posing it. Like, what is the point to it all? But
I don't know.
Pocket monster. We don't.
Yeah,
Just post up in Mount Moon for a little bit, looking for a chance.
Yeah, that's kind of fun. Though I'll say this: yeah, the wild encounters are still good. I enjoy that quite a bit, and they're still like dense enough that you will encounter them, but you're not hitting them about every like 3 steps to Mount Moon, for example.
And you can run away from them until they disappear.
And there you can like cool. chain combos to get more rare Pokemon. I think that's really cool. Game Explained had a cool video where you can even chain. Once you beat the game, you can fly. So you're just elevated above the map, but you can chain combos there to even get the legendary birds to spawn, which is really neat, especially if you're going for a specific type or feature for the Pokemon. So I think that's cool. I honestly think the catching is like fine. I don't miss like having to do like Thunder Wave and catch the Pokemon. I still think it's kind of enough, but it's a little more challenging than it is in Pokemon Go. But I just wish, like Andrew said, I wish the battling were more challenging. Okay, we'll move on. But
should have just been the next RPG. Okay, next.
Yeah.
I'm excited. Okay.
Skyward Sword for Switch. The story on this one is I believe it was Anuma, the longtime Zelda producer and kind of head of the that property. He said at Symphony of the Goddess Zelda concert, which I did go to when it was in Portland a couple years ago, it was excellent. Come on, buddy. Let me have my moment. I'm barely speaking on this. he said, he kind of teased, like, y'all want Skyward Sword on Switch, don't ya? And, like, everyone cheered, which was very generous. But I want to know your guys' thoughts. So it seems like this might be happening. We know we had Twilight Princess HD and Wind Waker HD before it on the Wii U, so it is next in line. Where does everyone fall on Skyward Sword and whether or not they would play it again on Switch?
I played it again because I never beat it. Because I didn't. I hated it so much.
Right? Strong feelings.
The motion controls were just no good.
I really loved it too.
I enjoyed the like one-to-one, you know, motion controls with the sword. And I don't know. I think that for me, that Zelda was all about the story. I think it had the best story of most Zeldas. And it's supposed to be... What, the first Zelda in terms of like the canon?
We'll consult the Historia, but yes.
I believe it is,
And I just really enjoyed that it was about the Master Sword, which, by the way, spoiler alert, is one of the characters I wish was a Smash character. Yeah. I would love to see it in HD. I think that Wind Waker looks absolutely gorgeous. I think the cell shading kind of lends itself to that. And this game has a similar aesthetic. And I think that just, like, basically what happened with Wind Waker was I saw it in HD, and I was like, oh, man, I'm going to have to buy it just because it looks so beautiful, and I want to be in that band. I don't have the same desire to be in the same world because it was super linear. And after, like, a world that we live in, that's going to be weird. Yeah. But I'm excited. If it's cheap and it's worth it.
It won't be cheap. Yes, I'm with you. So motion controls, here's the thing. They're going to be in this game, right? Because there's no way the whole game is built around them. And the pointer functionality in the Switch is worse than that of how it was for the Wii Motion Plus because there's no IR sensor. So the question mark is, I think they could probably get away with it all if they did some smart, you know, I think just coding for the Joy-Con and just kind of be more lenient, you know, because I felt like that was the frustration where it's like, I'm doing a diagonal slash and it doesn't feel like it registers. Then, you know, for motion controls, I think there's this feeling where if it doesn't work, it's like immediately the fault of the technology, which I think by and large is fair. But I never felt like, oh, maybe I didn't actually swing it correctly. I'm always like, it did register. Because the motions are simple, so you expect it to work each time you do it. So it is a question mark, though, if it does come for the Switch, what they do. Now, for the handheld mode, I personally would like to see, like, a touchscreen option. In terms of you play the game with the typical controls, but maybe there it is like, you know, you slash your finger to do the directional specific stuff. I think it would be a cool implementation. And I want to point towards one game. Again, I really enjoyed on the Wii with No More Heroes. And No More Heroes was an early Wii game, did not use Wii Motion Plus, but when you approached enemies, when you just mashed A to attack. When you did your finishing move, you slashed in a certain direction, but it was very loose. You could really slash anyway, like we know with the Wii, the early games particularly, and it would do this cool, very elaborate finisher.
Right.
That eventually came to PlayStation. You could use the move, but also you could just, like, on the second stick, swipe in the direction that it's prompting you for the finishing direction. And that would work. It'd be cool for Skyward Sword to do something like that, like with touchscreen if you're doing handheld. It would be cool to do it with the second stick, do the motion control for the entire game, but I feel like that would just take a lot out of it. It would be so easy.
I don't know how you do Skyward Sword without, like, I mean, the whole I feel like that's like a part of the soul of the game was that you're using the sword. And they can't. They can do the Wiimote stuff. With the Joy-Con, that's been proven. I don't know how great it's going to be, but imagine
it's
that...
It's kind of a little subpar, but yeah, you can. It also reminds me of, and Andrew will remember this, but Jedi Knight, Jedi Outcast. But you use the second analog stick to control the direction of the lightsaber. And you could...
I wonder if they'd come out with a peripheral. Right?
We're fine, I think. Yeah, if you hold like the left trigger or something, and then you hold the sword up. Yeah. It'd be like Samus's aim in GameCube.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Or good. Metro Prime.
I think if they took out some of the sword stuff, though, I don't know that it necessarily makes the game cheaper, but I would hope that they would be like, hey, like, we're releasing this game, it's a remake, we're not like, because, what's it called? Wind Waker, you know, was a full retail price game when it released. I would hope that this would be at least $10 cheaper, maybe. Or what they're gonna do is they're gonna fill it with like filler stuff, like and it comes with Skyward Sword, Breath of the Wild stuff. You can go back to that game and get like Tunic and Sword and all this stuff from that.
Twilight Princess, I think, was $50 or full price, but there was like a Wolf Link amiibo you get, but the maybe equaled out the price. I do think it's funny. I listened to the Game Explain conversation on it. And they said like it's one of those few experiences where you want the remaster to have like less content, and that would be nice to have some of the little rough edges kind of sand it off, like fighting the imprisoned so many times in the game, or like the Dao thing was not very fun. And I see like kind of the same way for Wind Waker, of course, it removed like some of the Triforce hunting and stuff like that at the end. Okay, well, that's kind of done. Let's go gut yay or nay to whether or not we would like to see it on Switch.
Yay!
Yay!
Yeah, I'll give it a yay. Okay, excellent. And then the last little topic I want to mention before we go to the headliner are two quick ones. One, Gris, I'm not sure how to say it, comes to the Switch on December 13th. That game looks beautiful. It's a platformer. It was at PAX on a huge screen at the Devolver Digital booth. Did not get a chance to play it, but it looked fantastic. I believe it's Devolver Digital. So I'm looking forward to that game. And the second thing that I'm really happy about, I want to tell you why, is Mario Tennis Aces is going to get Dell's Tournament, and you can play with a friend online that can join you. So this is in the update 2.1. It comes November 30th at 9 p.m. Eastern time. Yeah, exactly. So my feeling on this is it just a long time I've been saying, like, I appreciate for Switch this generation. Every game has had, like, support every first Nintendo game, right? Even Kirby, Star Allies, a game I did not love and felt was very easy, is now getting some hard mode bosses and more DLC that's free. I think that's, like, super cool. And I appreciate the long-term support and the use of the online infrastructure and structure of the console to kind of continually add content to their games, especially as Nintendo games never go down in price. It's nice that they like have a value.
They did a great job with their DLC across the board.
Sure, but I felt like all their DLC was just like things I had in the pipeline. They were kind of like sitting on it. Very little of it looked like fan replies, like, oh, fans want this, we're doing it. It's like, these are, you know, they have a plan, this is part of their pipeline for this game, and that's how it comes out. And I've always pointed to Mario Tennis Aces because it felt like it needed its online doubles. Andrew and I really had a nice time playing Mario Tennis, but we could not play doubles online, which is what you want to do for that cooperative bit. And there's no matchmaking with your friend. We know the matchmaking is terrible for Splatoon and Mario Kart, but it was a big problem because there were no tournaments. So it's nice to see this actual change. You can play doubles in tournaments. It really feels like it's fan-related in a way that surprises me for Nintendo, and I would like to see them implement this for Mario Party. A lot of people like
playable
online games together, more maps, a way to skip animation to move the courses more quickly. Well, you know, I always felt like to be down with that car, but nobody liked the car, but I liked the car. Everyone rode in, kept things moving fast, but everyone hates it. We won't bring it up now, but I would like to see some of those changes, the cart in Mario Party, at least something, because right now Mario Party is kind of the one big Nintendo game that does not have like a release schedule for DLC that we know of. What are your guys' thoughts on that?
Andrew?
If they release new boards, we all pick it up.
Mm-hmm.
The game is so fun. It needs, but just released. There's a half Pika release, and I feel like I was sitting there with my brother with his. He bought his Switch and he wanted to play. And he just wanted to kind of like lie in the other room and play on his Switch. And I had a friend over, wanted to play with him. just and you can't even do that. I just kind of wanted the, like the like Game Boy feature.
Right. Yeah. There's no handheld mode. You have to use the Joy-Con. There's no controller support.
But even just be able to be like for him and I to go online and play in the same game together sucked, and we didn't have to go online. We were in the same room, so even playing like a local party together without having to be on one screen, we couldn't do it. And that was
Yeah, you were already on life. You know, is that not enough? Am I right, boys?
Right.
That's what it's all about. Okay, here we go. So good summary, but boys, let's move on now to a little section we call the ANP headliner, our topic of the week. So, I think put some music in here, but for the video, it'll look awful and ruined. Okay, so for the check out our podcast on Apple Podcasts and Stitcher Store, and Andrew, what do you use for the podcast?
It's called Podcast Addict.
And he's like, I don't listen to the podcast.
There we go. And was, yeah, he's like, I'm the podcast. It's dying media. There's no money there.
read books, everyone.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you love reading. Yeah, why don't you put some of the books behind you? Okay, so what I want to talk about is this. So last week, Matt and Danny did an episode, this was actually 2 weeks ago, regarding the Super Smash Bros. Direct and kind of talking about it. Andrew and I were not part of that one, and this gives us an opportunity to talk a little bit about Smash, which we're now, like we said, a week from. Mm-hmm. But as far as the characters, in that Direct, we had both Ken as an Echo of Ryu, as well as Incineroar announced, which was exciting, and the Grinch leak, for those of you who are familiar with it, ended up being false. And we also had Piranha Plant shown as the first free DLC character if you buy it at the early point in its release. But we know it's the Fighter's Pass. It's $25. It'll release characters through 2020, and also the individually characters will be like $6.99, and it'll include the character, a stage, and some music. I want to say really fast, that's a much better value than it was in Smash 4. Smash 4, you had to buy those characters for 3DS and for Wii U, and the codes were like basically $8 a piece, especially for like Lucas, that felt like pretty raw. So I'm glad that they've kind of figured it for this, and even the way they phrased it was like, buy it if you want, I don't know if it's going to be good. But I want to just get your guys' thoughts on, there'll be 5 characters. Now, we know the way that Sakurai kind of framed it, he said that the characters would be characters that kind of were decided by Nintendo. Now, you might remember from Smash 4, there was like the fan voting, and we kind of feel like Bayonetta was the character that came out of that, although we never saw the official results. All of us thought maybe Shovel Knight was a big contender, Geno, characters that are not, as of yet, Bayonetta made it in, of course. So, from you guys, what characters do you think we might see? So, you can just any characters you think
what
of.
What characters do we think Nintendo has predetermined?
Yeah, exactly.
Is ready to or is working on it now.
Matt, you want to kick off with a thought?
Yeah, I'll do the first one. So, I would like to see Captain Toad. I've been talking about Captain Toad for a while. I know that are they in a trophy now? Is that confirmed?
No. Well, maybe that is.
I mean,
I don't remember.
So basically, Peach just like still pulling Toad out of thin air and using them as a. Right. The flyer.
Human shield, right.
Captain Toad has been in so much, and I really hope it doesn't get the arm treatment, which was really unfortunate, which I get. They didn't want to, I thought for sure arms would be in there, and they didn't want to, I don't know, bring up their fighting
maybe
game.
They will be.
Fighting game.
Right. Yeah, maybe, right now, they're just me costumes. Right.
But Captain Toad, I would like to see. I think that the moveset would be really interesting for a character that doesn't jump. Maybe like you could, so I could Sakurai introducing like the giant bird, like lifts him up and jumps, or something like creative like that.
So that could be an alternate costume.
Right. Yeah. So that'd be cool. That's my first one. I'm hoping that they've already decided on, but I don't think they'll show up.
Okay, Andrew, any thoughts?
I'm still hoping for Soma.
Castlevania.
Soma Cruz from Castlevania.
It would be nice to see that, particularly because right now there's a lot of enthusiasm behind the Castlevania Netflix show. It has Trevor Alucard and Sophia, the gal, I can't remember her name, from Castlevania 3, but it would be cool to have, since Castlevania seems like it might be coming back in some form.
You know, we need to have revisit. I mean, those were like some of the best games, but they seem to like ignore them for some reason.
Just makes all types of bad decisions across Metal Gear and Castlevania. So yes, but it would be nice to see them revisited, especially on a Nintendo handheld like the Switch. Okay, I'm going to jump in one.
Maybe,
so,
and one more ahead. Pokemon, maybe like Decidueye, also to go against Incineroar.
Oh, yes, that's a good thought. Now, actually, I'm going to use that segue. For myself, Reggie gave an interview for Black Friday when announcing the bundles, and he said that, you know, don't bother tweeting anymore, and Sakurai kind of said the same thing. I think they're tired of the Waluigi Twitter questions, and Sakurai would just not even talk about it. When asked specifically, I'm sorry, Reggie would talk about it when he was asked about Waluigi, he's like, I'm not here to discuss that. I'm not here to discuss Waluigi. So, in any event, although Waluigi would be like a good ceremonial final character, I'm looking ahead to 2019 in the big Switch games. And the big ones that come out are going to be Super Mario Bros. U Deluxe. I don't think we're going to see someone from that. Luigi's Mansion 3, Metroid Prime 4, Yoshi's Crafted World, Bayonetta 3, Fire Emblem Three Houses, Deus Ex Machina, kind of a little bit smaller one. So I think looking at that, one of those games, though, is the next Pokemon title, which we've mentioned. And I think one of the Pokemon from that, especially the DLC characters are going to run in February 2020. Oh. That game will be out. I think we'll get one of the starter Pokemon, just like we had Greninja, like running Incineroar, something we'll keep Charizard, keep it going.
Yeah, I think you're right, actually.
And,
well, I hope they announce that soon.
Yeah,
so that's the character that they'll release during that that quarter, you're saying?
Yeah, I think a later one. Another guess as a character, looking at those games coming out, I think we will take it to the bank, absolutely get one of the protagonists from Fire Emblem Three Houses. We got Corrin before Fire Emblem Fates came out. I know. A lot of characters, but I think for sure. I love Fire Emblem, but I'm like, yes, I agree with so many. But we got, you know, Corrin and Male and Female before we had that game. I think we'll have the same thing for
them,
this.
Though.
I know. But everyone's here for
that. Maybe like 20% of the Smash fan base actually knew who they were prior to their introduction. I'd say
15%. knows now. So it's yes, I think
we'll like for sure. Purple Fire Emblem guy and girl.
Does someone want to choose another character?
I have two. I'd like to see Paper Mario. But specifically, I don't know. We talked about like third party folks. I would like to see the SteamWorld Dig guy show up. I feel like they've developed a really great relationship with Nintendo over the past however many years.
Rusty is the name of the main guy.
Rusty,
the guy.
That's right.
Rusty.
And I think it'd be cool. I think it'd be a cool introduction. So they may show up as, I mean, you know, all the Aces trophy yet? Maybe not. Maybe they'll be that.
I think we do. And it won't be in there. I mean, the only Aces trophy that was third party like that, like Indy, was we didn't even get Shantae. That would have been obvious. But yes, those are good ones. Good ones. Do you have any more thoughts? No, no worries if you don't.
Skull Kid?
Yes, I still want... Okay, this is my thing, okay. Skull Kid, Gino, the other guys, Banjo-Kazooie.
The three amigos.
The three amigos, that's what we call them. Yep, the Choir Kids. It would be awesome to have those characters, but I just feel like if it really... You know, Nintendo has done a good job promoting things, right? Breath of the Wild had Xenoblade Chronicles 2, Rex's outfit was in it. Breath of the Wild Link appeared in Mario Kart, mind you, a bit afterwards, but did appear in that game. We have Animal Crossing next year as well. It's one I did not mention. I just think they're going to do something that promotes something they're trying to keep the momentum going with, more likely than, unless there's like a Super Mario RPG 2, I don't think we're going to get Geno. You know, I don't think we're going to get Skull Kid, unless there's Skull Kid appears somewhere, even though it would be an awesome character. I'd like to get him.
Remastered. They just did that, didn't they?
Yeah. But okay. It's
you
really
can't get everything, guys.
You know, it's so true. And we're thankful for what we have. Thanks for tuning in. Regarding the conversation about Zelda earlier, it would be nice if we could get all of the Zelda games on one place on the Switch. And that's the one thing that I hope Skyward Sword does include, like a button option without motion control to start future-proofing some of these games. You know, not that Nintendo ever does this, but it would be so nice to feel like Wind Waker, this is the version, and we can expect to see it. It would just be, that's a pipe dream, but like Majora's Mask came out on 3DS, it'd be cool to get on a Switch. You know, that would be an opportunity.
There's like a Zelda collection. Remember that little disc that came with
the
pre-order disc that came with
Ocarina of Time? Majora's Mask.
And you got like Master Quest, that quest, and then you had.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, because one of them. Exactly.
And like,
so one of
them that for like $300
that, that I never played, but were on there.
There were two discs or two different releases. The first one came out with Wind Waker pre-order, like you're mentioning that was Ocarina of Time and the Master's Quest. And then later there was another collection, which is like super rare one. It came with one of the GameCubes, and maybe like you get like a Nintendo Power subscription-ish thing. But like Andrew said, I think it had like Zelda 1, 2 in like the past, Majora's Mask and Ocarina. The menus loaded like really slowly, but it was like very cool.
Yeah,
well, that would be awesome. I'll never do it. All these games are too expensive. That tell us they're too expensive.
They could each be worth $60. So.
Right, they'll never do it. They will buy it.
Listen, I think it's interesting what you said, what you brought about, like upcoming games and potential those being potential character releases, specifically with Fire Emblem, and potentially Pokemon in the future. What about Animal Crossing? I mean, they tease Animal Crossing. They legitimately show, Tom Nook
in-game footage.
Watching from his office.
In-game engine.
Which is exactly how I watched the direct. Which was very cool. Do you see... So they already have some, like, promotion of the two. Do you see maybe another Animal Crossing character being, like, already, like, stated for one of these five?
I would love it. I mean, I would say this. The past few Animal Crossing games, there's never been distinct characters that are like this definitive representative of this game, right? Like City Folk, I wouldn't point to Tortimer the Turtle and say like, oh, for sure he's like the mayor guy he had promised. You know, like you wouldn't do that. The one exception though, the one difference I would say is Isabelle, right? Isabelle's definitive new leaf, and she's in this game. So I do think, Matt, to your point, if we got Animal Crossing, it was announced and there was like a clear character where this guy's like, hey, I'm like, you know, I work for the city in some capacity and I'm kind of a figurehead of this game, I wouldn't be surprised to see that character, and that'd be very cool.
See, I actually see it as being Nook. And he was the one that picked the letter in Brawl originally in that little cutscene when Villager goes running off, and then we see him again at his office. I think it'd be great to see him and his little nephews.
Tommy and Timmy are in those. Not sure. Huey, Dewey, and Louie, but only Louie and Dewey.
Do they come up in a Final Smash?
I don't know, but I'm excited. You know what makes me think kind of on that, Matt? So you're saying he got the letter and was kind of, you know, Villager took it and ran off. That's similar to in Smash 4, the Captain Falcon Fire Emblem trailer, where Krom is like, maybe I'll get in next time, like Lucy goes in, and of course we do get Krom. So it would be kind of this redemption of the character that is, you know, cheated out of their invite.
Right, and we see him like watching Smash from his office. Like, it'd be kind of cooler if he was brooding over it. Like,
I want him to come into this and be furious. Yeah, everyone's like in good spirits in this game, but not Nook. He's here for me, and he's here for kids. Yeah,
imagine if he just whipped out a bag of bells and just smacks you with it.
Absolutely. It's like Mr. Game Watch Side B, where it's like sometimes like really light. There's no bells in it. Sometimes it's like level 9 bells, and there's like a bunch and one hit KO. All right, boy, I think that's a good selection. Is there anything for you, the listener? Thank you much for listening and tuning in to our podcast. We'll be back with you next week. Maybe we get one last episode right before the release of Super Smash Bros. Ultimate. We're very excited. Thank you for again.
Thank you.
Bye.